Hello and welcome to the second panel for today. It is titled Why I Write. So for this, we have a fantastic set of ladies or well-known authors who are together here to discuss why they write, what prompts them to write, and how the pandemic has changed us, if at all, in our writings, and what is the writing process going to be. Our moderator for the day is Kanchana Banerjee, who is a well-known author who started her career with The Statesman, Kolkata, in 1993. And then she went on to work for Times of India in Hyderabad. She's the founder of Write Word and conducted online writing courses to help women learn the art of freelance writing. Our first panelist is Shuma Raha. The author Shuma Raha is the winner of Juggernaut Short Stories in 2017, a journalist formerly with The Telegraph and The Times of India. She continues to write columns for publications in India and abroad. Shuma dabbles in literary translations also, and her English translation of Bonafoul's Bangla novel Hate Bajare has been published by Sahitya Academy. Milan Vora is an author of four books. Her latest is Head Over Heels. Milan is a TEDx speaker and an awarded advertising professional. She has been creative director at India's leading advertising agencies. Milan also enjoys writing for publications, The Huffington Post, The Hindu, Cosmopolitan, Work, New Indian Express, among others. She's a big believer in doing what she loves. And Manjul Bajaj has worked in the field of environment and rural development before she became a writer. Her works have been shortlisted for the Hindu Literary Prize. She has also written two books for children. Her recent novel, In Search of He, was longlisted for Matrabhumi Book of the Year 2020 Prize and JCB Prize 2020. Her latest work is Locked Down, is a collection of micro poems on her experience of lockdown. I'll hand the session over to Kanchana Banerjee now, and look forward to a wonderful discussion.
Thank you so much, Deepshika. Thank you. Thank you, She the People, and Shelly, for having me over once again. A very good afternoon from a very cold, foggy, and dreary afternoon in Gurgaon. And what could be better, you know, and a more lively occasion than to spend the afternoon chatting with my favorite author friends whose books I've read, loved, and enjoyed. So welcome, Manjul, Shuma, and Milan. Wonderful to, you know, virtually be with you, if not be there together. So this is the best that one can hope for in a pandemic. So as an author, as a writer, possibly this is the most frequently asked question that authors face, that why do you write and how do you write? And as an author and a writer myself, I can say that it's often very frustrating to be able to answer this question, to be asked this question. And here I am with the same question, which I want to ask to my friends. Because I think, you know, like the entire process of writing, the entire creative process is so fascinating. And not only do readers like to know about the creative madness, the madness behind the entire method, or the method behind the madness. I, for one, while often I'm at loss for words to answer when I'm asked this question. So, but I just, you know, love kind of getting to know as to what propelled the thought, the idea, the plot. So I'll jump right into it, and I'll begin with you, Shuma. Shuma, I've read both your books. The first one, the collection of stories, and the second one, which was published by HarperCollins, on a very, very interesting, teasing, and a very very hotly debated and discussed topic of partner swapping. So tell us, you know, why is it that you write? What is it that propels you to write, your creative process?
You know, I guess I wanted to be a writer. I was in love with the idea of being a writer for several years. And I joined the newspapers almost days after I passed out of university. So I've been in the business of writing for almost my entire adult life, as it were. but that kind of writing was, it was mostly, it was mostly, you know, it was entirely based on facts. And it's it was reportage, it was interviews and analysis and so on. So somewhere along the line, while I was doing journalism and I was fairly successful at it, there was this kind of desire started in my, you know, mind that, you know, I wanted to do a different kind of writing, creative writing, and where I would not be constrained by facts. You know, I would tell stories and they would be born out of my imagination, perhaps obviously molded by my observation of people and places and so on, but they would not be constrained by facts, which is what my work was. So and it took me many years, in fact, to try and translate this desire into reality. But that is what was, that desire is what propelled me. And why I write, the main motive, I think part of it is, I think George Orwell put it best, that, you know, part of it is really sheer egotism. You want to, you know, you just want to be a writer. You want to be known. You want to seem clever. You want to be remembered. All of that, I think that plays a part in every writer. You're right. I mean, you just want to do something special. I didn't know if I was up to it. And obviously, one is a very, very long way off from achieving that kind of a recognition or anything like that. But I think that plays a part. But I did feel very strongly that I had stories to tell, and those kind of stories I could not tell in my line of work. But I couldn't start the process of creative writing didn't actually start until I had actually given up full time journalism. So and you asked me about the, you know, how it starts. It's really a journey.
Okay, so we will come back to the start of the creative process a little later. Milan, I'd like to go over to you now. I know, and most of your readers know, that you kind of, you know, have a parallel life in the advertising field, and how Love Asana began, and the competition, and you were kind of, you know, you won the competition, and that's how it started. But, you know, like, what I want to know from you is that what is it about writing that you love so much? Writing fiction. I'm not talking about writing as part of your advertising or the other work that you do. What is it about writing fiction that that propels you to write? Or what is it about a story? And you write beautiful, beautiful, you know, romances which are not sappy and not, you know, not very kind of very mushy gushy, very, you know, very contemporary rooted romances with the characters who kind of are very relatable in our today's world. So, you know, what is it about writing that you love so much that you want to do it again and again and again?
Thank you, Kanchana. Thanks for those kind words. Yeah, really. But I'll give you a small example of a parallel that I find with myself, which is, you know, I love singing. I sing at the drop of a hat. And I think I've been singing without being aware of it. Like, there is this impulse that suddenly makes me want to sing. You know, it's not with a view for somebody else to hear me. I remember once sitting behind my dad on a scooter, you know, we were on a two-wheeler and going somewhere, and my brother and me sandwiched at the back. And I remember I was singing because at that time the song came into my head and I had this urge to sing it. And I remember I became aware that I was singing aloud only when passers-by started looking at me. It sounds loony, but it still happens. You know, there is some impulse, some trigger. It's like the moment I'm in the shower and that water is running, I have to sing, even if it's a midnight bath. So that thing has to come out of you. And I discovered later that, you know, it was the same thing for writing, which is like, I remember once a cousin telling me that the first story I wrote was at the age of 6 or 7, you know, when I just started discovering, maybe 7 or 8, you know, and it started, the first line was, he let out a long sigh from the top and a small sigh from the bottom, you know. And so this was about some character which was, you know, your childish things, you know, making this situation of this weary person. So I think that need for, you know, telling a story has been there from the start. And as you said, Kanchana, I've been in advertising because, you know, at that time there was only that outlet for me to be able to tell a story. the moment I hear something, I've started fictionalizing it in my head and building something else from it. So, you know, when I got into advertising, there was no, you know, fiction writers was such a faraway world. They were so far removed, you know, the only Indian writers that you had exposure to were writing, you know, from, you know, say Anita Desai or whatever, you know, they just seemed very unattainable goals. And I don't think I entertained that idea, but I kept writing and I kept trying. As Shuma said that, you know, that writing gene was there, but I, for example, you know, even while I was, in advertising and taking a break after my first kid, I went and joined a playwriting workshop with Mahesh Tatani because I just kept wanting to find the way that I could write. You know, there was journaling that was all the time. So I have this huge collection of journals that goes back a very long time. So I tried playwriting and, then I also tried screenplay writing. But I think literally it was with fiction, where long and short, that I realized that, you know, this is the format that I'm feeling really happy with. And much before that contest happened, I had been writing short stories. And so happened that contest was, with Harley Quinn, and it was around romance. So a lot of the other writing has never found the kind of visibility that I'd like it to have. But I continue to write short stories, which are quite far removed from romance. But that thing of the moment you have an impulse or a trigger, that story needs to be told in some way. And I think that's what keeps me writing.
Lovely. Keeps me great. Sane. Great. So, Manjul, I come to you now. I love your style of writing. I love the subjects that you write about. They are serious, and yet you kind of, write about them in a very different manner, make it more contemporary. So tell me, Manjul, what is it about writing that kind of catches your fancy? What is it that makes you write and keep writing?
Okay, it's like being a reader. I mean, everybody here must be a reader if they're listening in. So it's like being a reader, but 10x or 30x of that. So instead of just getting to read and be involved in various lives, I mean, for the price of one life, you can have an infinite number of lives if you're reading, and you can be in different places. And when you're writing, it's like that same experience many times over, because you get to sort of inhabit the world and create it and be part of it. So for me, it's just the pleasure that writing gives, nothing else comes close. And when you start off writing, there's a fascination for being a writer. You've grown up reading, and that whole romantic thought of being a writer, wanting to be heard and seen and to be famous. But frankly, after you become a published author, some of that begins to wear off, because the world isn't out there waiting to, clap for you and root you on. And when you carry on writing, it's just for the pleasure, for the sheer sort of high I get from writing. That's why I'm still around. Though I may have begun with other ideas. I began with wanting to be a writer, with the romance around being a writer. But I'm here because it puts me in a great place.
Great.
I feel
I so agree with what you just said, Manjul, that there is this entire romantic notion of being a writer. People think it's very glamorous and it's very exciting. Yes, it is very exciting, but there is this there is this very hard toil behind the entire process, and there is a lot of there's a lot of detailed work that goes on behind the actual act of writing. And like most people think that writers just kind of wait for inspiration to strike. Yes, we do wait for inspiration to strike, but if we waited to kind of write when we felt like it, books won't get written. So with this, I come to the next part of the question, that for you and let's start with Milan, that what is the start of the creative process for you? Is it a character that comes to you? Is it a song that comes to you? Is it a plot that comes to you? How does your creative process start?
It's usually always been something which is like almost like a one-line plot summary. Somewhere there is just that one thing of, I want to write about say a reunion of old friends, and I want to write about it not in a glorified way, but you know, make it as real as possible, so that you know, you look at the old baggage, that look at everything. So for me, that trigger, for example, came from you know, a bunch of friends I grew up with. We kept planning a reunion, and one day it was just like that one bell that went off, which was saying like, this reunion is not going to happen, I'm going to write one, you know. So it started with that, and then it was like, now I'll show them, actually I'm going to create characters who are even more fun than all of them, and they're going to want to do that. So it started off with almost saying like, I'll have my revenge yet, you know. And then it kept growing. So then I could also you know, both of you said, Manjul and you know, Shuma, that you know, you get to also live out so many things. So many things where, you know, if I have lots of angst about a certain kind of person, then I can create that character and I can completely fully vent through that character. And only in my head, I know this, the genesis of that was this person, but now I've added X, Y, Z. And I can also, you know, get to do a lot of things in terms of living a more interesting life myself. If, you know, there are parts of me in that book, I get to be the one with, you know, witty repartee and things like that, which in real life, you know, I don't know about y'all, but I'm dull as dishwater, you know. So there are so many times you come away, you know, saying, I wish I thought of that, or I wish I thought of doing this or whatever. So you can, you know, keep weaving that in. But for me, the start is always with a basic premise. The characters then get fleshed out after that.
So tell me something, Shuma. Your last book, The Swap. It's about swapping of partners. How is it that you kind of, you know, arrived at such an interesting and such a hotly debated and discussed topic? What is it? How did the idea come to you? How and when did the idea come to you?
Well, you know, as Milan said, that it's often a, you know, one line story. You know, it's in your, suddenly something strikes you. And it's a one-line plot which is there, which has come to you. So what happened was, I was wanting to write a novel about married relationships, and I just didn't know how to go about it. You know, I mean, it's one of the most commonest topics ever. So I wanted to probe married relationships, what happens when boredom creeps in, ennui creeps in, and so on and so forth. You know, so. Now, it was just a chance discussion. I was just having a, you know, chat with friends, and this subject came up of couples swapping, that, you know, it's prevalent, etc. And that's when it suddenly struck me that maybe I could weave this story, this entire story of exploring marital relationships, which are, you know, not new, which are older, which are kind of frayed around the edges. And I felt that maybe I could do this around the fulcrum of this interesting subject. So that's how it happened. I mean, that's how I decided to explore this a little more. I did some research, obviously, and I found out that this does happen quite a bit, not just in the metros, but also in tier two, surprisingly, tier two towns as well. And that's how it happened, really. So, and I have discovered, as for the process of writing, you know, I think all of you will agree, all of you are authors, that, you know, you just start with something, but then what comes later, as you go on writing, it's a very different outcome often, because you kind of discover the story as you go on writing. I mean, I never have a very detailed plot written down. I find the plot as I go along, and that it's quite organic. So that's how it happens. And I completely agree with, you know, Manjul as well as Milan, that why are we here? You know, because it's a very hard slog. And one is here and one is not going to be famous anytime soon in that kind of
exactly. So,
yeah, and
we are not going to be able to buy an island off the coast of Spain, build a mansion, and call it the writer's
book. Yeah, but something propels you, even so, right? You feel so excited about being able to have thought of this thing, and you want to express it, and you want it to express it to the best of your ability. And there is joy in that also, that you are never achieving what you want to achieve, perhaps, that perfection that you're striving after, but you know, that whole process is so exciting and it's exhilarating. So that's why, you know, as Manjul said, that's why one is still here. So
Manjul, with you, I want to ask you a question with which one of my very close friends, Richa, who's also an author and has just released her third book or fourth book called Excess Baggage, and she just popped up a question that suppose if you have two very interesting subjects that you would want to write, how do you select which one to write?
You know, it's never happened to me before. I'm the kind of person who only reads one book at a time because I think it's disrespectful to be juggling two or three books, even as a reader. But I'm sort of so much of a stickler for this, like pay attention. And now I'm in this terrible state where I have three stories simultaneously going on in my head. And two are sort of being written together, like I two time between them, because I don't want to drop either. And it's not a place I like being in. I feel very sort of torn because one is in sort of Buddha's times. It involves a lot of ancient history and research. And the other is set in Bhutan, where I go very often to write. And it sort of tears me up. I'm not completely happy two timing. I wish they hadn't come to me at the same time. And while I was researching the Bhimta story, another story has come in my head. So suddenly I feel like there's a bomb ticking. I have to finish it all before the inspiration vanishes. I would rather write one story at a time. There's too many years to fill out. Why would you want to be in this tightrope trying to balance two or three of them?
So tell me, Milan, how do you like, you know, how do you select?
But Kanchana, let me throw that back at you, because I know that you are constantly also grappling with multiple ideas, right? Why don't you share that?
I do grapple with multiple ideas, but I'm quite a bit of a purist, and I can't, and I'm not a multitasker. I'm a very, very unitasker, and I find it very difficult to kind of, you know, juggle two, three, or, you know, like more than one stories at a time. So what I do is I focus on the story that I'm writing. And if something else kind of appeals to me, I just have, I have this huge collection of diaries and notebooks and et cetera. So I have separate notebooks for separate topics, and I just keep on jotting them. But I'm very faithful to the book that I'm writing, and I keep writing. But having said that, during this pandemic, I've been stuck in a very weird mind funk, and I've not been able to be as productive as I would have liked to. So I have shuffled from one topic to the other, and I've not been able to do justice to either. So I think I'm going to, you know, for the future, I'm going to keep sticking to my old and tested way of writing one book and jotting down points when they come to me about the other. So I prefer to do it one at a time. Okay, yeah. So Milan, you tell me, like, if more than one idea strikes to you, how do you select which one to write?
I know it sounds like a cliche, but the idea pretty much, you know, pulls you to it. You know, the one that's calling to you again and again. You know, and you talked about the pandemic. So I think for me, you know, before March, there were multiple ideas that were, you know, fighting for attention. And I started researching some of them simultaneously. It would be, again, it was like, it is not a good place to be in, because, you know, I also have these diaries, and I have a folder which has separators. So I keep pushing in reference material. I'm still writing by hand, everything. But the lockdown did one thing, which was that it's brought me a lot of clarity in what, needs to be done first, you know. So that sense of, you know, time is limited, mortality, all of that has kind of got very sharp and very clear. So I know what I need to do. If anything else comes and distracts me in between, I'll see. But the focus has gotten sharper.
Yeah. Mute. So with this, I want to come to the question of the of the plotting or the creative process as it goes on. And I know for a fact that Milan is a detailed detailed planner. She loves detailing all the characteristics, and this I know because you know I attended long back before I published my first book. I attended a writing workshop which a friend of mine and I had organized for a group called Write and Beyond, and Milan was the invited author to kind of address the group. And she had you know kind of taken us through as to how she details every minute characteristics of the character. So Milan, can you just take us through the kind of plotting and the kind of detailing you do?
I get very restless if I'm not able to have a proper structure. You know, it's like I can't get into the rooms of the house till I know exactly how I've planned the space in terms of the book. So I first have the basic premise that I begin with. Then I get into the characters and I get into, pretty much into, at least all the secondary characters and all that. And then there'll be characters who pop up in between, and you know, you need to evaluate if they are needed, or you know, they're somewhere, you know, you can combine to into one. Are they really necessary? But then I get into all the character details to quite an extent, and then I get into every little detail which helps me, you know. So even for a short story. So, I mean, obviously, you've got to work with the same sort of, way that helps you write.
Do you do detailed chapter outlines before you start writing?
I do chapter outlines. I mean, there's definitely, even within the chapter outline, there is a beginning, middle and end in terms of where it's going, where it's set, who are the characters in it. I think that kind of thing, which, you know, I would also like to give credit, you know, because that playwriting workshop that I did very long ago, Mahesh Tatani is a brilliant teacher. And I still fall back on you know, the way that he taught, the group how to write a play in terms of, you know, planning your scenes, in terms of writing scene cards. So even if I'm not writing scene cards now, but at least a chapter outline helps me. And I have deviated from it. I've reached points where I've fallen completely out of love with some character that I thought I'd take the ending towards. But I realized that, you know, even in that process, you realize that you've set up certain things which are adding up to that character. So whatever else you do, I may walk away and come back after months, even sometimes that block can hit me. But I rely on a plot very, very largely.
Great. What about you, Shuma? I just recollect that you kind of made a comment some time back in this in our discussion that you're a pretty organic writer and you just go with the flow. So take us through your writing style.
Mostly it is organic. I don't do detailed planning. My first book was a collection of 13 short stories. So every story has a beginning, middle and an end. And they're very, they're not just hanging in the air. They're not that kind of stories. So obviously, if in the case of every story, I had the basic idea in my head. I basically wanted to know where I was going, you know, where I would be going, what the ending would be. But I didn't know exactly how I would get there and how I would explore it. And Kanchana, you probably read the book. But I don't do detailed planning, but obviously, I do jot down points about characters. But I don't do very detailed planning at all. In the case of every one of those 13 stories, I knew the ending, I knew the beginning, but I didn't know how I would get there and exactly how I would, sort of explore it and find my way to the end. So those things happened. That happened organically in every case. As for the novel, I did a little more planning. With that, again, I knew the end. And I kind of wrote the ending well before I had reached it. So I knew the end. But again, the characterizations, I do make points. I do, make outlines of characters, exactly what attributes I wish to give them. And sometimes those attributes change as I go along a little bit, but not much. But I honestly, I don't do a lot of planning that way. Maybe for the next one, I should.
It's totally fine. There is, as I say, there is no right or wrong way. There's just the right way, as in the writing way,
So far, I haven't had a problem. I mean, it is just happening organically.
And like you, I also like to know the end of the story, and I write the end of the story, you know, much before I have reached the actual end of the story. I know how the story is ending.
Exactly. That gives me a lot of reassurance that I know it's there.
I know my destination. I have to reach there.
Yeah. I know where I'm going. Yeah. How I'm going to get there, I don't know, but I know where I have to go. So that gives me some kind of outline of kind of a format.
You know, and just to talk about my writing process, I was very influenced, and I'm glad I was, by after attending Milan's workshop, and I thought this is a very good way, because, you know, me being a Virgo, I like to do things in a very planned and a structured way. So I kind of, you know, got into detailed planning and etc., and it worked very well for the first two books. But as I was mentioning that in the lockdown, I've been in this crazy, you know, funk. So I was trying different things to do to kind of, you know, unlock my mind. And I tried the Pansler way of working, and it didn't work for me at all. So Milan, I'm back to a detailed, crazy psycho planner. I like to do very detailed planning, to have chapter outlines and you know, and of course, I mean, like one always has the option or the freedom to kind of go off the track if one wants to. But yeah, I like to plan detail. What about you, Manjul? You know, how is it that you write? How have you written In Search of Heal, which is such a beautiful book?
You know, I start with an idea. I start with what's bothering me about life. Like, most of my writing is an exploration of things that perplex me. So I say In Search of Heal started off with the question that, is true love even possible in a world of inequality when the gender relations are so messed up between men and women? What is love about? So that was sort of, and it's a question I was trying to answer. It's not something that I know the answer for. And then you set it against this love story, which is, famous and well-known. And there's the impulse to travel to Punjab and all the, you know, what one has been exposed to names as a child, because my parents came from across the border. So the names, Jung and Sialkot. So there's a lot of romance around them. So you pick up little streams of your life and you pick up the questions, and it's pretty much organic. And for here, of course, I knew more or less the structure of the story because I'm not the first person telling it. But for other things, I would say till about halfway through, I have no idea where my story is going. And then I reach out for the end. But initially, it's just the setting, which is very important to me. Like, where are we? And my characters were very, very important to me. And the questions that their interactions are asking of each other. And somewhere, say, two-thirds of the way through the book, I start worrying about exactly where is this leading to. And I never write in one draft. So my first draft is just to get the plot right. Mm-hmm. And then to get the other nuances right. The plot, this first story I tell is this story I'm telling myself. It'll look very different from the final version that the reader might see. So, you know, you top it up with more things. But yeah, I start with setting and character more than with plot. Plot matters a lot, but it comes in as part of the writing process. So, and I tried does chapter outlines and character. It didn't work for me. Everybody was in rebellion, and I couldn't write that story.
it's so fascinating to kind of know about the writing process, and each varies from the other, and it's such a wonderful journey, you know, the kind of, so you know, given that we're still in the throes of a pandemic, do you think more people are going to write because we are stuck at home? Is this going to give birth to a lot more writers writing? Milan, what do you think about it?
I think so. I mean, I'm just looking at even the fact that a lot of people are even exploring self-publishing a lot more now, you know, where earlier it was kind of a no-no, you know, you're thinking that, no, I still want to, you know, have the physical book. I think a lot of that shift has happened in the mind itself, in terms of what you want from when you write. You just, you know, earlier, if you thought you want to have the book in your hands, or all of that, which was connected with the other rewards of writing, let's say, you know, somebody else, you know, being able to access it, whatever. But I think now you've accepted that it's changed. And, you know, a lot of people are even, I think, turning to, you know, so many different formats now. I've seen that happening in the middle of the pandemic. I've had a lot of people reaching out and saying, can you tell us how to? Because I also experimented for the first time with self-publishing in the course of the lockdown. Till then, it had been the previous three books had all been with traditional mainstream publishers. And, you know, it just opened different doors. And I think that sense of urgency that people have, that there is a story, and they say there's a book in everyone, right? So at least everybody wants to get that one book out. I see that there is going to be a lot more writing that's happened, and we'll start seeing it coming out in different ways.
Okay. So we just have just 5 minutes to go, and before we just wrap up. So Shuma, tell us, you know, like, I mean, what do you think? You think the pandemic is going to change the way we write books, the way books are out, come out, you know, traditional versus self-published, you know, like what are your thoughts on this?
I think I agree with Milan, because the pandemic has, you know, it's kind of brought a sea change to the way we live, you know, to normalcy, what is normal. I mean, you keep hearing the, this quite awful phrase now, new normal, but that is what it is. Right. And people are going to be much more flexible about what kind of publishing format, or they're going to be much more open to, you know, going for self-publishing, because people want to express themselves. And this this way of idea of mortality, of the finiteness of one's time here on earth, I think that feeling is must be quite sharp. I mean, it's sharp in me now. You know, because you find people dying around you, people you know, falling severely sick and all of that. Mm-hmm. So I think people who are creative, people who want to express themselves will not want to waste any more time. They will want to do it. And if traditional publishing is not exactly knocking on your door, you will just go the other way. And I don't think people will wait for, you know, wait years and years, which one used to hear, you know, earlier, that people just go on doing the rounds, publishing rounds, pound the pavement, etc., etc. They won't do it. I think that change will happen, and it is already happening, I'm sure.
So, Manjil, over to you now. You know, what is your take on this, you know, given the fact that you've been stuck in the pandemic for so long? How do you see this changing books, writing, yourself and others?
I did publish one little sort of book of micro poems, but that was for the fun of it. I don't see myself anytime actually moving to self-publishing, Bodhi Bistar Leke kind of thing. Because I feel what traditional publishing does is it curates content. And if you're sort of, you know, ambitious for a certain kind of readership, because how do you reach the readers you want to reach if you're self-published? I haven't cracked that one. So, everything is happening simultaneously. More people are moving to Kindle, more people are self-publishing. But I don't really see anything other than traditional publishing as a choice for myself, you know, because you're sort of fixated on that notion of a writer, and you're a writer when the world says you're a writer. You're not a writer when you say you're a writer, unfortunately. You know, so all of that sort of is needed. So my directive to myself is always weaken your ambition and strengthen your craft. And, you know, that's where I hang out. And so if all of us want to be writers, it's not really good to... You know, I mean, self-publishing is wonderful. Some people have done great things with it, but it's not the automatic route to me still.
I think Milan, you wanted to say something?
No, I was saying that for me also, Manjul, it was an adventure. It was a way to survive the pandemic.
Yeah, I've done that.
Say that I need to get something out, and the kind of response that it got, which was so immediate. But again, for me, you know, that need to you know, work with what else a traditional publisher gives is far outweighs, you know. But I wouldn't, you know, say that, I wouldn't agree with you, Manjul, that you're not a writer till the world says so, because I think that
somewhere in your heart, right?
Manjul, huh? Manjul and Milan, I'm sorry, I'm getting text alerts from Deepshika, and we have to end the session here because the time is almost up. And I just wish we could go on and on chatting, because you know these kind of questions, these topics are really never ending. And unfortunately, we do have a time, and I have kind of overshot by a few seconds. But thank you all of you, Milan, Shuma, Manjul. Wonderful to see you. Wonderful to hear you talk. And thank you, Shelly. Thank you, Shree, the people, for giving us this platform and this opportunity of coming together. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for making this happen. Thank you, ladies. You.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, Kanchana.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.